Welcome to the colloquium today. We have Julie Comerford visiting us from University of Colorado in Boulder. And I actually Googled to try to get some scoop on her personal life, but I really didn't succeed at all.
Good.
It told me she was born in 1904 in Pittsburgh, Pennsylvania.
Looking pretty good for 110.
Yeah. But actually, she got her undergraduate degree in astrophysics at Princeton, her PhD at UC Berkeley, and then two fellowships, I think, at UT Austin, and now she's an assistant professor at UC Boulder. So what Julie does is she takes a lot of different observational approaches to seeking and studying dual black holes, sometimes binaries, and possibly things that will coalesce in the future. And she studies the wreckage that they're found in, the galaxy mergers. And I did find a Wired magazine article from 2010 that said, "The universe is one big dance party for black holes." So that sounds pretty good. So she'll talk about tracing galaxy evolution with observations of dual supermassive black holes.
All right, thanks, Paul. So I'll be talking about how we can use these observations of supermassive black holes mainly as a means of probing the fueling of AGN in galaxy mergers. And I'll be highlighting work done by my group at Colorado. Becky Nevin is a second-year graduate student. She's doing optical long-slit spectroscopy. She's leading her first observing run in 2 weeks. Scott Barrows is a postdoc who's working on Chandra and HST data, so the X-ray, optical near-infrared data. And Francisco Mueller-Sanchez is a postdoc who's working on radio data and also near-infrared IFU observations. So we're a very multi-wavelength group, which is good because AGN are very multi-wavelength beasts. So we want to study these black hole pairs in the context of galaxy evolution. So I'll give you a quick, dirty overview of what I mean by a merger-driven galaxy evolution. So we're going to start with a galaxy, a single galaxy with a central supermassive black hole at its heart, merge that with another galaxy. And so this galaxy merger induces tidal torques that funnel its gas towards the center of the merger remnant galaxy. So this gas fuels bursts of new star formation. It accretes onto the supermassive black hole and powers it as an AGN. So we enter this very active phase, the Ullerg phase, where there's lots of star formation happening, lots of AGN activity. But eventually, feedback from the stars and from the AGN will blow out the remaining gas. So with no more gas and dust around, we can't form new stars. We can no longer fuel the AGN. So gradually, the merger remnant begins to redden and fade until we're left with a bright red and dead elliptical galaxy. So this picture of merger-driven galaxy evolution leads to several open questions. So we've seen that galaxy mergers can funnel gas onto the black holes and fuel them as AGN, but that's not the only way that you can fuel AGN. You can also power AGN through stochastic processes like accretion of gas along the bar, funneling a bar into the black hole. And so we can have merger-driven AGN activity and also stochastic-driven AGN activity outside of mergers. And so we want to understand in what cases we power AGN in galaxy mergers. And it's been suggested from simulations that the most luminous AGN are the ones that are found in galaxy mergers most often. But this has proven difficult to measure observationally, and the observational results are in conflict. And that's because of the difficulty in identifying AGN that are in galaxy mergers. Really, the problem is in identifying galaxy mergers observationally. So we use their morphologies, their usual visual classifications or quantitative methods, but there are all sorts of selection effects. There's dust obscuration, redshift-dependent surface brightness dimming that'll give you misclassifications of mergers. And so the nature of this link is not clear from the observations because of this difficulty of identifying galaxy mergers. Now, all of this accretion that's happening during mergers also builds up the mass of a black hole, and so we want to know how much mass growth happens during galaxy mergers. And finally, the merger between two black holes leads to the merger of two galaxies leads to the merger of two supermassive black holes, which emit gravitational radiation that future gravitational wave detection experiments can detect. So we'd like to know how often black holes are merging so we can predict what kind of observational signature black hole gravity wave experiments can detect. And so during this talk, I'm going to present dual supermassive black holes as a new observational tool that we can use to gain insights on these types of open questions in the field of galaxy evolution. So let's go back and look at this galaxy merger again, but this time let's follow along with what's happening to the black holes in the merger. So we start out with two galaxies, each with a central black hole, with large separations of tens of kiloparsec. We can follow as the merger continues, the two black holes are brought closer together until they're brought into the same merger remnant galaxy. And here, this is known as the dual supermassive black hole phase. So here, the black holes are orbiting in the potential of the galaxy at velocities of a few hundred kilometers a second. They're separated by a few kiloparsecs. And dynamical friction from the surrounding stars will make this pair continue to tighten up in its orbit until it forms a binary system. And so here, the binary system is a gravitationally bound black hole system. And the velocities are much higher, thousands of kilometers a second now, and the separations are much smaller, less than a parsec. So we expect that these binaries should ultimately coalesce, emit gravitational waves, and leave us with the paradigm of a single galaxy with a single black hole again. So you can see that these black hole pairs are good tracers of the entire merger process. And so observationally, if we want to go out and find these black hole pairs, our job is the easiest when they have the largest separations. So at these sorts of separations, there are hundreds of black hole pairs known with separations of tens of kiloparsecs. And one stunning example is this galaxy found by Paul Green. This is in the X-ray. You can see there are two quasars here. You can see some tidal tails in the Magellan image. And the separation here is 21 kiloparsecs. So we know of hundreds of these sorts of quasar pairs, which are sometimes called binary quasars, at these sorts of large separations. But as we go to smaller and smaller separations, it becomes more difficult to observationally resolve, spatially resolve, and confirm these pairs, to the point where there are only a handful of known duals and lots of candidates, but so far no confirmed binaries. And that's just because of the observational difficulty in spatially resolving something with a separation of less than a parsec. So my work focuses on the dual phase because this is the smallest separation black hole pairs that we've so far been able to spatially resolve and confirm in the data. Okay, so how do we find these black hole pairs? Well, we can find them if one or both of the black holes is accreting gas as an AGN. And so this is my attempt at a schematic drawing of what these sorts of merger systems should look like. So this is supposed to be a galaxy with a tidal tail, but it looks more like a curling stone to me. So we've got this overall merger remnant galaxy with the tidal tail. We've got the two remnant stellar bulges from the two merging galaxies. So most of the stars are stripped off to form all this, but there's a stellar core is left over, and that's where the two supermassive black holes are hidden. And so in the case where we have gas accreting onto one and we see one as an AGN, call these offset AGN systems, because you should see a galaxy merger remnant with one AGN that's offset from the center. And so here's a real-life example of an offset AGN. This is a nearby disturbed disk galaxy that Aaron Barth found, where here's the core of the galaxy, and it's got these two other companions, and this one right here is a confirmed AGN. It's separated by 5 kiloparsecs from the center of the primary galaxy's nucleus. So this is, so far, the only published example of an offset AGN. So an AGN with a separation less than 10 kiloparsecs. Now, if we have enough gas available to both supermassive black holes, we can fuel them both as AGN in a case called dual AGN. And here, the most famous example is NGC 6240, which is this Euler galaxy where, if you look at the center in X-rays, you see these two hard X-ray sources that correspond to two AGNs separated by a kiloparsec. Okay, so we want to go out and look for these dual supermassive black holes as either offset AGN or dual AGN. And we can use them to come at these open questions at galaxy evolution. So I mentioned the observational difficulty of finding merger galaxies. Well, these offset and dual AGN, by definition, are AGN in galaxy mergers, so they can offer us a clean observational sample of AGN in mergers that we can use as a new way of getting at these types of questions. And I also mentioned that the dual supermassive black holes are the small separation black hole pairs we've been able to confirm so far. So they can offer us the tightest observational constraints on the black hole merger in spiral timescales that are important for gravitational wave experiments to know. So this is what we want to use the offset and dual AGN for. So we want to go out and find them, but should they actually be out there? Well, the simulations say yes, there should be many examples of these dual and offset AGN out here. So here's just one example of a simulation done by Laura Blecka, who was a graduate student here. This is showing the separation between the two black holes in a merger and how it progresses as the merger goes on in time. And here Laura's shown the phases where one black hole is active, so this would be the offset AGN, and in purple where they're both as active as dual AGN. And these gray stripes show when the black hole separations are below 10 kiloparsecs, so the dual supermassive black hole phase. So from the simulations, we see that, yes, these sorts of things should exist. And now I'm going to focus just on the dual AGN for a while. I'm going to come back to the offset AGN towards the end. But just focusing on the dual, so there should be lots of them out there according to the simulations, but surprisingly few dual AGN have been found. So as of 5 years ago, this was the state of the field. There were four known dual AGNs. And these were found all by chance. People were looking at the galaxies for other purposes, and they happened to find that these galaxies hosted two AGN, either in the X-rays, like here, here, or in the radio, like this and this. And I want to especially point out this galaxy, O402, because this is the smallest separation black hole pair that's so far been confirmed. 7 parsecs separation. Okay, so that's as low as we've been able to go so far. Okay, so if we want to use dual AGN to learn something about galaxy evolution, we're going to need more than four. So we're going to set out and do a systematic search to actually try to find these dual AGN in larger numbers so we can use them for answering these types of open questions in galaxy evolution and move past these anecdotal examples of individual systems that have been found. So I'll describe how we do this. So we start out with large spectroscopic samples of galaxies, and we look for the galaxy spectra where we see AGN emission lines that are double peaked. And so the idea is, here are some emission lines in oxygen-3 produced by an AGN, and the dashed lines show the systemic redshift of the galaxy based on the host galaxy stars. And if there are two AGN swirling around in this galaxy, then we should be able to see the spectroscopic signature of a relative blue-shifted line and a relative red-shifted line. So this is the type of spectroscopic signature we're going to start to look for dual AGN. And so the first place we did this was with the Deep2 Galaxy Redshift Survey, and we found two of these with separations around 400, 600 kilometers a second between the double peaks. Now, the great thing about Deep2 is that all the data was taken with DEIMOS. So that means we have 2D spectra for all of the objects in Deep2. And so the 2D spectra are useful because we can see the spatial extent of the emission in the galaxy as well. And so here are what the 2D spectra look like for these objects. So this is just showing the oxygen-3. You can see there's two emission peaks. You can see the separation in velocity or wavelength here. But then also we have this spatial information about the position along the slit. So you can see one emission component is a little higher than the other. We can measure that spatial separation, which is about 1 kiloparsec in this case. So if these objects are actually dual AGN, then we start to see something about what they're doing, that they're separated in velocity by 400 or 600 kilometers a second relative to each other, and that they're separated by 1 or 2 kiloparsecs spatially on the sky. So deep 2 is great, but if this is only 2%, 1 or 2% of AGN have these double peaked profiles, we're going to need a much bigger sample of spectra if we want to find these in any decent numbers. And so the place you want to go for that is Sloan. And so Sloan is big enough that even though these double peaks only occur 1% of the time, we can still find hundreds of examples of double peaked AGN. And that was what was done in these three independent papers looking for these double peaks. So the great thing about Sloan is its size, but the limitation of Sloan is that it uses a fiber-fed spectrograph. So we don't have any of that spatial information like we did with Deep 2 about what the separations of the emission components are and what the physical geometry is. So that leads me to step 2, which is to take all these double-peaked AGN in Sloan and start to get long-slit spectroscopy of them so we can see the spatial profile of the emission and start to sort out which of these might actually be dual AGN. So the reason we need to do this is that double peaks can be produced by dual AGN, the relative motion of dual AGN in a merger, but they can also be produced by other effects, such as disk rotation, where you're seeing the redshifted and blue-shifted component of a rotating disk, or by an AGN outflow, where you're seeing the redshift and blue-shifted components of a biconical outflow. Okay, so double peaks alone are not enough. We have to do follow-up observations. And so that's the point of the long slit data. So just to show you an example of an AGN outflow, this is a nearby galaxy that's well known to have an outflow. This is it, all the outflowing emission in O3. And if we add up at all this emission, then we get this 1D spectrum. So there are those familiar double peaks, but this is not a merger at all. This is just an AGN outflow. Okay. So this is the model for this particular AGN outflow. So here's the biconical structure. Here's their long slit data, spatial position versus wavelength or velocity. And then this is their biconical model fit, shown in the gray regions to the data. So these outflows have a very specific extended structure in the long slit data that we can use to start help to separate out which of our double peaks are being produced by outflows and which actually might be dual AGN. So we've done this for about 40% of the sample in Sloan so far using a variety of different telescopes. Well, lately we've been using Apache Point Observatory, and that's the work that Becky Nevin is doing. So the strategy is this. So here's our galaxy. This is the double peak spectrum. Now, we don't know where in this galaxy the AGN emission is coming from, so we don't know where to place our slit. So what we do is we observe at 2 orthogonal slit position angles to fully constrain where the emission is coming from within that 3 arc second fiber diameter. So we observe first at 1 position angle. That gives us this spectrum. So we see these 2 emission components corresponding to the double peaks, so the same velocity splitting. But then now we can also measure the spatial separation. So we'll call that x1. We observe this galaxy again at the orthogonal position angle. That gives us this spectrum. So there are the 2 emission components. This time there's hardly any spatial separation. Measure that. And so we've observed this galaxy at 2 different position angles, measured 2 different separations. So with a little trigonometry, you can turn that into the full spatial separation and orientation on the sky of the 2 emission components. Okay, so we're able to fully constrain what the separation and orientation of the 2 emission components are on the sky using these 2 orthogonal slit viewing angles. Okay, so here's what the data look like. So for each example, we have one, the double peak spectrum from Sloan, and then the 2 slit position angles. So you can see some of them look quite compact, and some of them look extended in a variety of different ways. So we can start to use these observations to sift out which ones are looking like outflows and which ones are still good candidates for the dual AGN. And so we measured the spatial separations of the emission components on the sky, and this is the histogram of the separations that we're finding. So all of the spatials, in every case we see two emission components with a spatial separation less than the Sloan fiber size. And the median separation is around a kiloparsec. So whatever is producing these double peak lines is something that's happening on kiloparsec scales. Okay. So we're getting somewhere. And some objects, we also find there are two emission components that actually line up with the position of two stellar bulges that are seen in adaptive optics images of the host galaxy. So these ones are particularly interesting cases because what this could be is these are the remnant stellar bulges of the merging galaxies. They each have a central AGN that we're seeing in the O3 emission in the long slit spectra. So these types of objects are particularly compelling candidates for dual AGN. But I want to stress that we don't have a true confirmation of a dual AGN until we can spatially resolve both AGN either in X-ray or in radio. So in the radio, we're getting VLA data for 71 of the double peaked objects. And here the idea is we want to find two flat spectrum radio cores like in 0402 to confirm a dual AGN. And in the X-ray, we're getting Chandra and HST data for 10 of the double peaked AGN. And here we're hoping to see two X-ray sources like in NGC 6240 to confirm dual AGN. So I'll start out telling you about the radio observations. So two of the double peaked AGN have been published as being observed with the VLA. One turned out to be a dual AGN, the other turned out to be a radio jet driven outflow. And in the X-ray, there have been, Shin Liu has published a paper with observations of four of the double peaked AGN. Two of them turned out to be dual AGN, and two of them only had a detection of one X-ray source, so those were still unclear. Okay, so going to the radio data, we've taken the full sample of all of the double peaked AGN in Sloan that are redshifts less than 0.1, and that's 71 objects. And so we've decided to get long slit observations and radio data for this full sample of 71 objects. So this project is in process, it's ongoing, but I can show you the results from the first 16 double peaked AGN that we've classified so far. And this is work that's being done by Francisco Mueller Sanchez. So far out of these first 16, we found three examples of dual AGN. And the way that we know they're dual AGN is in the radio, in the VLA data, we see two compact radio cores that have flat spectra. And in this image, I'm also showing, we have long slit data for all of these, so we know the position angle of the O3 emission. And so the O3 emission lines up exactly with the locations of these two radio sources as well. And we also know the PA of the major axis of the galaxy based on the Sloan photometry. So in all these examples of the dual AGN, we see two flat spectrum radio cores that line up with the two emission components and also are in the plane of the host galaxy. And so these three objects we found so far have separations of around a kiloparsec. Now, if you're anything like me, you want to see what the host galaxies look like for these guys. So here's what they look like in Sloan. So you can see, well, they don't look terribly exciting. You wouldn't have picked them out as being mergers based on their visual morphologies. And this underscores the observational difficulty in using morphologies to classify mergers. Because if you're just going through looking at morphologies, these things would not have jumped out at you. This one looks like He's interacting with this one. This one's got a tidal tail, so this one looks like something's going on. But this one looks pretty uniform. This one just looks like a disk. And here are the radio data showing the double flat spectrum radio cores in each of these that show that they're hosting dual AGN. Now, what we'd love to do is get high resolution imaging of these host galaxies so we can actually see what's going on in the inside. Are there double stellar cores? Is there extended tidal features that we're just not making out in the Sloan data? So HST or AO imaging of these objects would be great for that. Okay, so in addition to the double flat spectrum radio cores, we also find some examples where there's a single flat spectrum radio core but then extended radio emission that has a steep spectrum. And so these are examples of steep spectrum radio jets. And you can see the radio jet is aligned with the position angle of the extended oxygen 3 emission, but in this case, not aligned with the PA of the galaxy. And we find 5 examples like this. And what these are their AGN outflows that are being driven by radio jets. Okay. So we definitely do have outflows in our sample, and thanks to the radio data, we can even tell what's driving the outflows in these cases. So for our results for the first 16 objects that we've determined their identities with the radio and optical data, this is what we're finding. So I've shown you the examples of the dual AGN and the radio jet-driven outflows. That's half of the sample. The other half, we only detect one radio source, no extended radio features. And so we rely on the optical long slit data to tell us what's going on and what's producing the double peaks. So if the long slit data is following a Keplerian rotation profile, we interpret it as a rotating disk. If it's extended and follows a line stratification structure of an outflow, then we interpret it as an AGN outflow that doesn't have a radio jet driving it. So this would be a radiatively or a mechanically driven AGN outflow. So these are the results based on just the first 16 objects, so these are still small number statistics, but once we do the full analysis for the all 71, we'll be able to nail down these proportions better. But this is where we're headed. Okay, so once we have all the 71 objects, we've determined the sources of the double peaked emission, now we want to place them in some broader context of galaxy evolution. And so what we're doing is teaming up with Laura Blecka to compare our data with her simulations of AGN in galaxy mergers and in isolated galaxies. So what Laura does is she merges two galaxies, she follows what happens with the gas when it's fueling AGN, and then she can actually make mock spectra of what these mergers would look like if we were observing them with Sloan or with our long slit data. And so here's her example of a double peaked profile that's being produced by just disk rotation in a non-merging galaxy. And this is the long slit spectrum that would go with that. And here's an example of a double peaked AGN that's produced by dual AGN and the long slit spectra that would go with that. So there's several things that we want to do by combining the simulations with the observations. So first of all, we know that we've selected these candidates for dual AGN in a very specific way. We're looking only for things that have large line of sight velocity separations produce double peaks. So we're missing everything with large transverse velocity separations because they wouldn't produce a double peak profile. So the simulations can help us understand our selection biases. So Laura can do these simulations and she could tell you exactly what the spectra will look like for all dual AGN, whether they're producing double peaks or not. And then we can go back and compare to our sample to figure out how many objects we're missing because of our double peak criteria and help put the results that we find in the broader context of what the dual AGN are actually doing and what kind of spectral signatures they produce. And the simulations can also help us identify the sources of the double peaks in our data. So here she's got, you know, model spectra of what disk rotation and dual AGN look like, and also for AGN outflows, so we can compare the simulations of that to our data to help us sort out which are disks and which are outflows and which are dual AGN. Now, you notice that I didn't show an example here of what a spectrum would look like for an ADN outflow, and that's because ADN outflows are really hard to model numerically. And so far from our data, we're finding 70% of these double peaks are produced by outflows. So we've actually got this large homogeneous set of observations of outflows with all this long slit and radio data that we can use for Laura to inform her models of AGN outflows. Specifically, the radio data is great because we know that those specific cases are radio jet driven, so she can model radio jet driven outflows numerically. So that's another thing we're doing, is using the outflows to help not just the simulations inform the observations, but also observations inform the simulations. And another thing that we'd like to do is take these observations of dual AGN, put them in the broader theoretical context so we can turn them into actual black hole in spiral timescales. So we can get estimates of how long it takes black holes to merge, so that gravitational wave experiments know which sort of signals they should detect. So here's an example of, this is showing the time until merger from the simulations plotted against the projected black hole separation. And these three dashed lines are our three dual AGN that we found so far in the radio data. And so we can use these results to kind of get an idea of the possible time scales on which the black holes will actually merge. So here, let's see, it goes from 10 megayears all the way up to 300 megayears. So that's quite a large spread. So we're looking at other observables we can put in there to help constrain that more. For example, the AGN luminosity we could use as a third axis here. But ultimately, combining our dual AGN with the simulations are going to enable us to provide tight observationally based constraints on the black hole merger, on black hole in spiral timescales. So that's another one of the things that we're going to be doing in the future with this sample. Okay, so moving on to the X-ray data. So I mentioned you can confirm dual AGN in radio or in X-rays. So in the X-ray, we've gotten this Chandra and HST data for 10 of the double peaked AGN that we also have long slit data for. And in 6 out of the 10, we find that these galaxies are mergers, where you can see two stellar bulges. So two in all of these. So we also see we have long slit data, so we see O3 emission coinciding with both of the stellar bulges in all of these cases. And so we just want the X-ray data to confirm, is there really an AGN in both of these bulges or only in one? So all of these have at least one AGN, so they're all either offset or dual AGN. So 6 out of the 10 turn out to be offset or dual AGN. Now, one of the interesting things that came out of the Chandra data has to do with the hard X-ray luminosity and how it compares to the O3 luminosity. So it turns out that the dual AGN have much lower X-ray luminosities compared to fixed O3 than single AGN do. Okay, so for the dual AGN, we weren't getting as much X-ray flux as we would if they were single AGN. So we think what's going on here is, well, these dual AGN are in mergers. Mergers are triggering these gas inflows towards the center of the galaxy. So you have these high absorbing gas columns that are preferentially absorbing the X-ray emission that's produced near the accretion disk, more so than the O3 emission, which is produced on more extended spatial scales of the narrow line region. So we think it's the excess of gas at the center of the mergers that's producing this lower observed X-ray luminosity for the dual AGN that are mergers compared to single AGN. Now, this is something new that we didn't know before. So when we set up this Chandra program, we used the scaling relation between O3 and X-ray luminosity for single AGN. So you see where I'm going with this. We didn't detect as many X-ray counts in the dual AGN as we thought we would. And so it's made it difficult to tell which of these 6 galaxies are actually offset AGN versus real dual AGN. So I won't make any firm conclusions about that yet, because we're still trying to tease out the data. But really what we need is deeper Chandra observations so that we can get next year deeper Chandra observations so we can get the X-ray fluxes that we need to make the firm detections of whether there is a second ADN there or not. But for now, I'll just call all these things, they're either dual or offset ADN, okay? Okay, so, but they are ADN in mergers, so we can use them to start to get at these open questions in galaxy evolution that I talked about in the beginning. So I mentioned the prediction from theory that the highest luminosity ADN are the ones that are in mergers. And so this is a luminosity function from Phil Hopkins. This is showing that the lower luminosity ADN are preferentially stochastically fueled, so outside of mergers, whereas the higher luminosity ADN are the ones that are preferentially fueled in mergers. And so what we can do is take our sample of 6 offset or dual AGN, the ones in mergers, compare them to the 4 that were isolated AGN, not in mergers. And this is very small number statistics, but we do find that the ones in galaxy mergers are more luminous on average. So this is a first step of observational evidence that, yes, indeed, the lower luminosity AGN are less likely to be in mergers than the high luminosity AGN are more likely to be merger fueled. Okay, so I've laid out this whole grand plan, all these observations that we're doing to try to find these dual AGN that turn out to be 20% of the 1% of AGN that are double peaked AGN. Okay, so it's tough work, it's tough going, but how have we been doing? Look how high this is going to go. Yeah. So this was the state of the art at the beginning of the talk. There were 4 known dual AGN. They were all found serendipitously. Okay, let's start looking. 2009, we start looking. So first data comes in. And this is not just us. There's lots of groups that have been out there looking for dual AGN and finding dual AGN in radio and X-rays and all the rest. So we start finding a couple in 2011. Some of the first radio data comes in. Some X-ray data comes in. To the point where today we've got 16 confirmations of dual AGN. So these are AGN separations less than 10 kiloparsecs. So we've gone from 4 to 16. Okay. And then we've got all this new radio and long slit data coming in. And so if the same success rate of about 20% applies, then that means that next year we could be up there. So 26 or so, if the first 16 are indicative of what the rest of the radio and long slit data is going to look like. Okay, so look at this, power law, exponential increase. We're going to be like, shh.
And if you get 6 times Chandra time?
Yeah. Oh. That's up to you guys. Yeah, thanks, Ramesh, for that plug. Okay, So it's been working. We've been building up a sample of AGNs. We can actually use them to learn something about galaxy evolution. Okay. So now I've been talking all about the dual AGN, but now I want to talk about the offset AGN, so the case where only one of the black holes is being fueled as an AGN. And this is an even newer area. Very little has been done on this. I told you this is the only one that's been published of an offset AGN. So we decided to do the same thing, go and look for these things. Again, starting with deep 2. And so this time, instead of looking for double peaked lines, we look for single peaked AGN emission lines, but that exhibit some relative blue shift or red shift relative to the systemic of the host galaxy. Okay, so this is an example of an offset AGN that would have a relative red shift. But it can be either way, blue shift or red shift. So we did this in deep 2. We found some blue shifted lines, some red shifted lines. But again, if you want to find these things in large numbers, Sloan is the place to be. So in Sloan, we found 350 of these. So This is showing you the stellar absorption lines. This is calcium H and K, so this is what we use to set the systemic redshift of the host galaxy. And then those dashed lines come back over here, showing the systemic, and then you see that the AGN has a little bit blue shift here, or a little bit redshift here, a little bit blue shift. So we're finding about 2% of all the AGN in Sloan have these shifts, and these are shifts that we can measure that with confidence that they're inconsistent with zero, so usually shifts greater than 50 kilometers a second. But if you take into account all the small velocity shifts that you should get due to projection effects, then maybe it's 5% of the total AGN population have velocity shifted lines. Okay, so again, these are candidates. These sorts of shifts can be produced by outflows, same thing as with the double peaks. And so we'll have to get some follow-up observations. But first, I just want to show you, this is the fraction of AGN that have these offset lines as a function of the AGN bolometric luminosity. And so you can see that the more luminous an AGN is, the more likely it will have a velocity offset line. So I want to emphasize that these are just candidates for offset AGN. We don't actually know what's producing the velocity shifts yet. But if the same trend holds true for bona fide offset AGN, then this is more observational evidence that the higher luminosity AGN are preferentially triggered in mergers, because an offset AGN is an AGN in a merger. Okay, so now the follow-up observations. Okay, this is more work that's being done by Francisco Mueller Sanchez. So we went to Keck and used OSIRIS just to observe four of these things, just to see what the gas is doing, what the AGN emission is doing, what's causing these velocity shifts in the lines. And so here's an example of one of these galaxies. So this is showing a map of the stars. So you can see the stars are centered right here. This is the map of the Passion Alpha emission from the AGN. And you can see the peak of the AGN is off-center from the peak of the stars, which is shown in the contours. Okay, so it's a velocity offset. We know that from the Sloan spectrum. And now we're also seeing a spatial offset. But this is not an offset AGN. This is actually an outflow. So this is the map of the velocity of the gas and Francisco's model of it as an AGN, biconical AGN outflow. And so he can actually get out the energy of the outflow and all that too. So three of the four that we observed were this type of thing, where it has spatially offset emission, but it's an outflow. And then one of them, again, we saw that the AGN emission is offset from the center, but this time, this is actually along a bar in the center of this galaxy. So we think we're seeing an inflow of gas here, and that this is actually gas falling onto the black hole. So as a control, we also observed one AGN that had no velocity offset at all. And there's its stars, there's its AGN emission, they're exactly lined up. So this was a nice boring control example of no velocity offset, no spatial offset. But the interesting thing is that the four velocity offset objects we looked at, they all did also have spatial offsets of the emission. It's just that none of them turned out to be offset AGN yet. We've only observed four. But we're also getting some Chandra and HST data for eight of these to look for. In Chandra, we'll show you the position of the X-ray source is the AGN. Compare that to HST data, shows you where the center of the galaxy is. So we've got that data coming in now, too, and that's what Scott Barrows is working on. So far, no, we haven't had any confirmations of an offset AGN. All right. So you set out fishing for a certain kind of fish. You cast your net, and you find those fish, but then sometimes you find other creatures that are more interesting in their own ways. So in the last few minutes, I'm going to show you a couple of my lobsters that have come out of the search for the dual and offset AGN. So this afternoon at the ITC lunch, I talked in detail about this galaxy, so I'll mention it just briefly here. This is Cosmos J1000. This is a galaxy merger remnant. You can see the tidal tail. It's got two nuclei separated by half an arc second, or 2.5 kiloparsecs at this redshift. And we and the group here at Harvard, especially Francesca Chivano, have done a lot of follow-up work on this object to try to figure out what it is, because it's got a broad line component to the spectrum that's offset in velocity by 1,300 kilometers a second. So that's the kind of velocity offset that could be produced by a black hole that's been kicked due to gravitational wave emission after a merger of two black holes. So this object is exciting because it might be a gravitational wave recoil kicked black hole, or it could be the result of a triple black hole interaction where two of the black holes merged and are in this core, and then the third lightest one got thrown out. Or it could be, which is now vanilla, dual AGN, where the broad line velocity offset is produced by an outflow. So we're working on more follow-up observations to figure out exactly what this lobster is, but whatever kind it is, it's definitely an interesting galaxy. And the other one I want to show you is actually from one of the double-peaked AGN. So this thing has double-peaked lines in Sloan. It was observed by Jenny Green, and so she saw this extended stellar profile with a remnant tidal tail here, so it looks like a merger remnant galaxy. It's got these two nuclei. And then from her long slit data, this is O3 in the long slit, she sees O3 associated with both nuclei, this bubble here, and then this extended O3 emission all the way out to this companion galaxy up here. So this is really extended O3 emission, at least on 20 kiloparsec scales. So it's an outflow, but the question is, what is powering this outflow? This is 10 to the 44 or 10 to the 45 ergs per second outflow. So it's not radio jet driven, because this is a radio quiet galaxy. It's not star formation driven, because there's no evidence of young or intermediate age stars in this galaxy. It's all got old stars. And so Jenny's interpretation is that it must be a quasar driven outflow. And so this was one of the objects in our HST Chandra program. And so we also saw the extended outflow in H alpha here. And so quasar-driven feedback, or these large-scale outflows, are often invoked as a means of expelling cold gas from a galaxy, shutting down star formation, starving the AGN. But there haven't been many observational examples of large-scale quasar feedback. And so this is one of the examples of quasar-driven outflow on large scales that could produce the feedback that all the models want to shut down star formation after mergers. So this is a great object because it's quasar-driven feedback, it's double-peaked, it's got these two cores. At least this one's definitely a quasar. This one, it's actually hard to tell if this is an AGN or not because there's all these extended soft X-rays associated with the bubble here. And so this one we actually already are getting more Chandra data on. And so about a year from now, we'll know more about this object and whether this is actually a secondary AGN there or not. So this could be dual AGN plus quasar-driven feedback. Okay. So to summarize, so we've been carrying out the first systematic survey searching for dual supermassive black holes, which are visible as offset or dual AGN. So we start by selecting them as double-peaked or velocity offset lines in large spectroscopic catalogs like Sloan. We do follow-up observations, for example, in the long slit. But then really, to get confirmations, we need to observe these things in X-ray or radio. And so the first results that have come out of this is, well, we're up to 16 confirmations of dual AGN so far, with more data coming in. We're finding evidence we have these AGN are definitely in mergers, so they're a clean sample of AGN in mergers that show that the higher luminosity AGN are preferentially triggered in galaxy mergers. So that's observational evidence in support of the theory. So of these six objects in Chandra and Sloan that are in galaxy mergers, four of them are in major mergers, and two of them are in minor mergers. So especially the minor merger ones are interesting to me because we need to find out a way to explain how we're getting all this gas available to fuel these AGN while we only have a minor merger. So it'd be interesting to look at the gas masses of these. So our next step is to take all this radial and long slit data, combine it with the simulations, so we can start to put things in some context, understand our observational selection biases, learn about black hole merging in spiral timescales, and start to model AGN outflows using all the observational data we have on the outflows now. And I showed you a couple of lobsters. But I love these things. These things always pop out of the data. When you're doing a survey for one thing, you always find something else that drags you in a new direction. All right, thank you.
So Julie can entertain questions.
So you talked about the dual AGN having lower X-ray ratio and interpreted it in terms of the X-ray. How about the O3? Is it normal for a normal galaxy, or is it strong in these?
Yeah, the O3 is normal, so we can compare it against the single peaked AGN in galaxies of similar masses and redshifts. And so the O3 seems okay. So we think it has to do with the X-rays.
About 15 years ago, Romanova published models showing a black hole misaligned with the rotation axis of a galaxy. Mm-hmm. Can that produce these double peak profiles you see in the emission?
A black hole that's
misaligned with the rotation axis of the galaxy, like Sagittarius A star in our own galaxy,
okay.
Misaligned.
Okay,
and that would be because of an accretion event.
Yeah, if it was an active black hole, then if it's misaligned, and so it's not at the bottom of the host galaxy potential, so it's got some motion, then you could see velocity shifts in the line, like the ones we're looking for.
Most mergers of galaxies occur between galaxies that are very unequal in size. So doesn't that get your statistics back up? I mean, there'll be 10 times as many of them as there are these ones that are approximately equal that you're finding.
Right. So that's why the idea of how many are major mergers versus minor mergers intrigues me, because the prediction from theory is that dual AGN should be in major mergers, because that's where all the gas is. That's mixing up the potential the most, getting all the gas down to the AGN. And so the minor mergers are more common. So maybe if only a few minor mergers produce a dual AGN, they're still so much more common that maybe the numbers that we're finding tell us something about how often dual AGN occur in minor mergers. And so that's one of the things we want to do, is back that out and compare to how many you have of every mass ratio of merger versus how many we're finding of dual AGN in different mass ratios. So you can compare the observations of merger mass ratios to what we're finding dual AGN.
I noticed you searched for dual AGN using narrow emission lines.
Yes.
Did you try search using broad emission lines, or separate broad line regions?
Oh, that's a good question. So the reason that we stay away from broad lines is that people use broad lines to search for the binaries, so the very, very small separation pairs where the narrow line regions will be overlapping.
Yeah.
And so then you can look for binaries, double peak lines. And so we stay away from the binaries. That's been, lots of great people are working on that. We want to find the larger separations, so the narrow lines should be going along with the broad, everything should be going at the same velocities together, the narrow lines and the broad lines together.
I wonder if you have already a statistics that you are looking for. I mean, do you have a prediction how many dual AGN you would find for among AGN in general? Is there a prediction already?
Yeah, so that's where we've got this huge selection bias of the double peaks.
Yeah.
So that's where the simulations are going to help us put it in the broader context. So right now, all I can tell you is that out of double peaked AGNs, 20% of them so far have turned out to be dual AGN. And double peaked AGNs are 1% of all AGNs. So take all galaxies, 5% are AGN, 1% are double peaks, 20%.
But I mean, there is prediction, theoretical prediction, or you don't have something?
Yeah. So that's what we're getting from Laura's work,
okay.
Is that she can just merge galaxies and just look when they turn on as dual AGN, how long they spend as dual AGN, the different separations. So we're actually looking at,
are we just finding dual AGNs at kiloparsec scale separations because that's where they spend the most time? And so with the simulations, we're able to piece that all together and figure out, for example, how the AGN fraction increases as the black hole separation decreases. But we need to know the time scale in order to do that. Yeah.
So, Julie, among all the objects you showed, this Rodriguez object is really fantastic because it's just parsecs separation.
Yes.
So have you thought of any strategy to find more such objects?
Okay, so if you want small separation,
what
you want is ELVI. Okay, so that gives you the best spatial resolution that, that really you can do. And so we've started with the VLA can get us down. We use the A configuration to get us down to 0.2 arc seconds. But we put in a proposal for some VLBI observations for some of these that we think will be even smaller.
That would be fabulous to get a few more.
I'll work on it for you.
Yeah, because you know this whole last parsec problem.
Yeah.
We really want to know what is the rate at which these objects come to these close separations, and then gravitational waves can take hold. We need statistics from the observers.
Yep. So we need to push it as far as we can go, which is what VLBI is going
good.
For.
Okay.
Here.
I was thinking kind of along the same lines, like, is there any sense to searching for the very closest ones in VLBI, or do you want to try and identify candidates some other way?
So Sarah Burke's follower has done an extensive search through all the radio data looking for binaries, so the very small separation ones, and she's got this paper with this whole search, and she didn't find any existing data. But now what she's doing is taking...
How many objects?
Oh, I couldn't tell you. I could send
some,
you...
Some huge number.
Oh, yeah, it's... She took all the archival VLA data that
and
works,
got
so,
zero.
And got zero, which is why I don't count binaries. But now what she's doing is taking binary candidates that were selected spectroscopically as having these glossy offset broad lines, and she's doing follow-up observations of them with VLBI, so that is a potentially promising way to find these. So there'll be good stuff coming from her.
All of these have a sufficient radio flux to do VLBI.
Oh, yeah. So the details of her VLBI survey, I'm sure she's picking the right targets. For ours, so this is a question I get asked sometimes, you know, only 10% of AGN are radio loud, but you're doing radio observations of all of them. You're not even going to see most of them. But we detect all of them. Most of them are radio quiet. We detect all of them. So we have the sensitivity to even detect the radio quiet ones. So I have to remind myself that radio quiet does not equal radio silent. We're still able to see them.
And so are the upcoming spectroscopic surveys going to be really good at finding more candidates, or is Sloan going to be the state of the art for a while?
Yeah, so at Colorado, we bought into the Sloan 4, and so I'm excited about the MANGA survey. So that'll be, we'll have IFU data for a lot of active galaxies, and so then they just give you the data. So look for a mission that's not at the center, where it's supposed to be. So I think that'll be a good resource for us. But anything that's really a large spectroscopic survey is good for this, because they're rare objects, so you need a lot of data to start with, or a huge sample to start with to find them in any numbers.
And what, can you mention something about the active optics?
The AO observation.
Yeah.
So that's Haifu and Rosalie McGurk and Dave Rosario have been doing AO near-infrared imaging of the host galaxies of the double peaks and looking for ones that have two cores in them. And so that's another way to get it. Good candidates, if they have two cores, okay, then you know, you can do some extra observations with, you know, Chandra or the VLA to see if they both correspond to AGN.
Is that limited to galaxies that have a nearby bright star, or?
Not if you use the laser.
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay, let's thank Julie again.